And how are you all this morning on this beautiful, it's a summer's day here in East London, South Africa. One of my favorite subjects has actually been called fear. And I think that it certainly is something that we all struggle with. And if I look back, I was just thinking to myself now, if you think of when you were going to go and write an exam, when you were at school, and what was the first thing that you did when you went to go and write an exam, just before the exam? The very first thing that you did is you probably went to the bathroom. And you'll notice that speakers, or even you know, anytime that you've got to do something serious or nerve-wracking, the first thing you do is you go to the loo. And one of the metaphysical things, which is very interesting for me, is that if I remember Louise Hay, she always said, fear is connected directly to your bladder meridian. And I mean, all the East and things of the needle, acupuncture and stuff, they all work on meridians. So it's very interesting how your anxiety and your fear relates directly to your body in actual fact. So it impacts. So how do we know we're in fear? Fear is not a bad thing. So don't get me wrong. Fear is not a bad thing. We have to have fear in order to survive. But it's when it takes over. It's when it takes over our body. It takes over our lives. And I'm sure that either you suffer from anxiety. And if you think about what is anxiety, what is fear? It's like an underlying, and I was thinking to myself, who better than me as a guru to teach you about, and the fear guru, because it's something that I've had my whole life. And I realized that I really was struggled with fear and anxiety when I was 38 and sitting in the waiting room and waiting for my test results. And I realized, oh my God, I can't actually deal with this. I can't cope with this. And what happened was, I started to work with the power of now. And there was a very important book in my life called, by Eckhart Tolle, called The Power of Now. Because I knew that I needed to understand that. And people generally, if you look at the world today, it's inherent in us. We are born to feel fear. And it's a survival technique. It makes us survive. But when it takes over your life and everything becomes very fearful, anything anyone says you react to, you're always anxious, you've always got this thing in your body that's churning and working and moving around. So let's just start. PowerPoint I've got here for you. Sorry, I've got the wrong thing here now. Beyond fear is really working to find how we can find peace in our lives. Do any of you suffer from anxiety or fear? Is there any of you that feel, you know, it's almost an impossibility to not suffer from fear and anxiety, because it's something that runs our everyday life. So if you, for example, have sore shoulders or neck tension or anything like that, you know, that's very obvious that we're suffering from some kind of anxiety, because that's really where our fear and things actually hits us. It hits us directly into our body. And it's basically what happens to us is when we become overprotective, when we protect ourselves to such an extent that we become armored. You know, and I know quite a few people in my life who are lovely people, but they protect themselves. So behind that protection is fear. And what is it really? You know, I've really got into this, because that's why I said to you, I'm like the fear specialist anxiety guru. Because of my own fear that I suffer and maybe still suffer. Even this morning before this talk, I thought, oh my God, what happens? And it's always about what's going to happen in the future, isn't it? Isn't that what's so very interesting about fear? So Beyond Fear by Don Miguel Ruiz, death is not the biggest fear we have. Our biggest fear is taking the risk to be alive. The risk to be alive and express what we really are. We're so afraid that people will reject us, that what will people think? We're even afraid to love. We're afraid to love. We're afraid to open ourselves up. And, you know, as you all know, those who know me really well know my work, is that you know that my work is all about emotions. It's a very emotional, you know, different chapters and things in my world about emotions. And one of my chapters in my book called Sky Meets Land is on fear. So these images of mine that I've worked with for 30 years are metaphors. They're metaphors for emotions. And also have deep energy on how one can actually break the anxiety in your life. So the old chair, the universal trigger for fear is that the threat of harm is triggered, isn't it? We're going to be harmed. And 9 times out of 10, we ask ourselves, because I think of a quote I once read by Mark Twain, most of the things that we think or imagine in our lives never really happens to us, does it? The threat can be for our physical, emotional, or psychological well-being. So if you really think about fear, if you sit right now where you're sitting listening to me, and be honest with yourself, where in your body do you feel any kind of tension or anxiety or stress? Because unless you're sitting in meditation constantly, and even then you're really aware of your tension, but where do you feel this? Where do you feel this? We can learn to become afraid of nearly anything. I mean, I read a silly thing. The people are, you know, it's like the silliest things that people are afraid of: bananas, monkeys, the blue sky. So people are, and generally you can sense fear a mile away by looking at, you know, looking in people's eyes, looking in people's hearts. And anger comes from fear. You know, anger is certainly an emotion that dominates the world, isn't it? When you really dig down beyond that, what do you find there? You find sadness. And behind sadness, you find fear, really. So much of our fear is below consciousness, and it affects our body. It affects our body. If there was a circle, I'm trying to think who drew that. There was a circle, and below the circle was a line, or the circle was cut in half, and below that line is a space where people function from fear. Most of our problems in this life is not due to a lack of love. It's actually due to the fact that fear is so prominent, because love within us never goes away. So it becomes our way of thinking, our way of life. And you know, here I've illustrated through this beautiful image of mine, this black and white image, I've illustrated the fear for protection, which is really like how we are, you know, hiding behind the brother, you know, watching, observing, not really coming out yet as a full lion. So what do humans fear the most? Social phobia seemed to be the greatest thing. And this is a kind of thing that, again, it's a subject that should come up at school. It should be part of our upbringing. You know, I think I would like to say I come from quite an anxious background in terms of mum was always saying, always thinking about what could go wrong. Mum was always thinking about the future. And so I was trained like that. I was taught to think like that. So also, we're worried about what other people think, aren't we? So apparently one in 20 people have social phobia. I think it's a lot more than that. And this beautiful image of mine here, it reminds me, it's a metaphor for us, you know, our shadow selves, how we hide behind the light within us. And we hide, and the shadows are, you know, the places where we have to go. And so if we, you know, fear stops us from doing the smallest things. I mean, even just waking up in the morning and facing the day, we just feel afraid, or we feel anxious, or we always have some kind of tension or anxiety running, you know, running through us. In fact, Every day we produce horror movies in our lives, don't we? In our minds, we produce these horror movies that we're afraid to watch, and nobody else wants to watch our horror movies. You know, I always say, well, what's the worst thing that can happen? You know, if we're afraid, and I know a lot of people are in a lot of difficult situations in the time that we're living in now. There's a lot of fear around many things, because we don't know what's happening. And so this thing runs through our veins. It's a very living, real thing in our body. And it comes from an early age. You know, I read somewhere, all roads lead to fear. You know, when fear is unprocessed and we have not worked through our fear, it has to go somewhere. So it goes in the form of stress and anxiety. So very much a metaphor with my image, as above, so below. You know, if our thinking, because where does fear come from? Let's face it comes from our thinking. Whatever thoughts we have, whatever thoughts we're processing, it can't come from anywhere else other than the way we think. So what we have to do is really to come up with a whole new way of thinking. And it's a shame. It's a real pity that people run away from terminology like meditation or yoga. I mean, I've seen crazy Facebook posts saying that meditation is evil and yoga is evil. I mean, what absolute rubbish. What ignorance. And I feel very strongly about that. What ignorance. Because when we're ignorant about something, then we fear that. So I would never have been able to cope without meditation and deep breathing, learning how to stretch your muscles, learning how to relax, sitting in a process of meditation. So the ancient wisdom tells us that when fear is not faced, it becomes toxic. So if you have a look at how many toxic people are living in this life and working in this life and living, they might be staying in your house. They might be working, you know, they might be working in the same job as you. So when you don't face your fears, you yourself become toxic and you try to make everyone else around you as toxic as possible. Because so fear drives, it's not really, I don't know if it's money that makes the world go around. I think it's fear that makes the world go around. And the thing is that love, we'll get to that now. You know, we are designed basically to live from a point of fear. It's our natural thing, the same as any other animal. You know, if we check in with our bodies, we can realize that we're actually plugged into fear. If you did that right now, if you just checked into your body. Now, the upside of facing our fears is really understanding that we are courageous. And I have faced some pretty fearful situations, you know, life-threatening disease 3 times. That's pretty scary, facing the death of my father, facing all sorts of things, you know, facing cancer, facing all sorts of things, the death of my mother. And I'm sure each of you sitting watching this can list, we are trained to think that when fear comes, we think it is bad. But rather than facing our fear, because fear is not going to go away. So when we get into a fear state, when we get into a fearful state, we almost get into a trance, really, because it starts to spiral down. We become very small. We become very small and we become disconnected from ourselves. We become disconnected from life and we shrink from the world. We actually become self-destructive and we destruct everything around us. We will try everything to try and run away from our fear. You know, our fear basically keeps us. It traps us. And as we know, whatever we think about, we create. So 9 times out of 10, whatever you're fearing, it's going to actually come true. It's almost a guarantee. So what have we got to do? You know, what do we do? You know, how do we go beyond fear? First of all, one of the things is that we have to look after something in our bodies called the parasympathetic nervous system. So I printed this out today. The parasympathetic nervous system is responsible for the body's rest and digestive response when the body's relaxed, resting or feeding. It basically undoes the work of the sympathetic division after a stressful situation. The parasympathetic nervous system decreases respiration and heart rate and increases digestion. So why do I know this? I know this because I'm speaking to you again from my own experience of anxiety and fear, because that was a lot of my upbringing. Always, you know, how many of you, I admire and I miss my mom and I love my mom, but one of the things she would say when I left the house for school, be careful. And how many of you say that to your children? Be careful. So what should we be saying? We should be saying, go out and have a fantastic day and be courageous no matter what you face. So already just saying, be careful, look after yourself. Already we are implanting the fear around fear. And there are ways to take time out from fear. You know, to take time out, it's impossible to think clearly when you're flooded with fear and anxiety, and it really is. It's true. How many of us are in turmoil because we can't think clearly, actually, and it just keeps, and then you ask a fearful person for help and they make you even more fearful. So breathing through the panic is to get the heartbeat. You know if you've got anxiety, if you've got sweaty palms and hands and things like that. And so what do we do? You know, what do we do when, how do we get out of this? I mean, that is why meditation is so important, because most of the time we're up against in life. Remember, you may not be fearful. Well, I pretty guarantee every single one of us has got some kind of fear running us, because otherwise, you know, otherwise we wouldn't be able to live. But it's when it takes over, when you panic, when your anxiety, and notice how much of the day we are tensing about what is about to come, thinking about what's going to happen in the future. That's really what's placing us in this terrible position of fear. So how do we solve this? What do we do? You know, what do we do? What do we do to overcome this? So there's certain things, you know, we say facing our fears, and I'll get to that now, but just basic things like breathing. We haven't been taught to even, you know, how to cope with this. You know, imagine the worst situation and look at it. So I lose my job, I lose my house, I lose my family, so I'll sit on the gutter. So that's like the worst. Or I'll be so sick. And then what? So once you have a look at your fear and you actually face your fear head on, we live in a society that strives to make us perfect. You know, we are imperfect and we're perfect. So already that is, and we come from a school system and a culture. And I talk about the religious system, the school system, the educational system, the medical system, all the systems. Look at them. They want us to be perfect. They don't say, I want you to become the best you. What they try and do is that they try and make everybody the same. And that is a very stressful system, because I'm not the same as you. And you're not the same as me. So now I've got to become like this under a mold that has been taught to us, that this is how, this is what life is about. This is how, what you, this is what a human being is. And none of that is true. So we live in a very stressful environment. And the things that we become scared of is, I'm not going to perform well. I have a fear of separation. That's a huge thing. I mean, even you find it in animals. They also have a fear of, and then we have FOMO, fear of missing out. You know, I've got some of that. Have you got some of that? The loss of our own life. You know, if you think about it, what is it that we're so afraid of losing? So if we notice some of these things, you know, if we notice some of these things, and just by my beautiful image of my daisies, this was a metaphor for growth, you know, a metaphor for turning our light up to the sun, turning our light up to the sun, and knowing that even although underneath the ground is darkness, and it's got to be compost and worms eating the compost, but there is a way out of tension and anxiety. There really is a way out. Well, there's a way to manage it. And the way to manage it is by pausing. Catching your breath and pausing. You know, one of the great things is that if you notice an animal, let's notice a duck. when a duck has had tension and a fight on water with another duck, what does it do? It turns around, it moves, and it shakes. It just shakes, and it's forgotten. All that tension's gone, isn't it? You'll also notice animals. I've noticed my dogs or someone else's dogs or the cats, when you stroke them and they pick up your vibration, they pick up 9 times out of 10, they're picking up your anxiety or your vibes. What does an animal do? It shakes. It gets rid of the tension. So we don't move. What do? We just pack it on. We keep packing it on and on and on and on our shoulders, don't we? We keep packing the anxiety and the fear on. We keep it in our solar plexus. We keep it in our chests. We keep it on our shoulders. And then we believe that it's real. You see, that's what's mad about this, is that we believe that it's real. And I'm not saying that you can go and shake out a childhood trauma. I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying there's a different process to that. I'm talking about everyday tension and stresses, which probably comes from our childhood. But there are different ways. Did you know that I'm just reading something that I wrote down here. Did you know that the word worry is derived from the word strangle? Isn't that interesting? So we strangle ourselves every single day with worry and anxiety about what is going to happen in the future. And what happens to us, we don't feel safe. You see, so when we don't feel safe, then we try to make everyone around us make us feel safe. We try to pack an environment. We want to move to an environment where we feel safe. We don't realize that this anxiety and tension and fear is an actual fact coming, you know, it's coming from us, and it disconnects us from who we are, disconnects us from the people around us. So I love this image. I've always loved this image, and I have many calming images, but this for me is one of the most, and I produced this image straight after I'd spent a few weeks in an ashram in India, and I remember producing this image after that. I'd taken it, and I'd kept it for about 2 years, but the energy and the metaphor in this image, Elohites, has got the most, well, it actually has got the vibe and the energy, because when I work, I channel energy from whatever I'm photographing. This image has got the most beautiful, energetic calmness. And when you sit in the presence of this, so there's various things that you do, that one can do to reduce the fear, to reduce the tension. You know, the first thing we've got to do is we've actually got to hit this fear straight on. We've got to dive into the fear. We've got to close. That's what's so beautiful about meditation. And this coming Sunday, I'm doing a beautiful meditation on releasing fear in the Wild at Heart retreat. So if any of you want to join, just let me know or pop me an email. So one of the things is we have to start pausing, looking at the fear, sitting with the fear. Where is it in our bodies? Where is this fear sitting in our bodies? Because there is nothing out there that's harming us. And I'm not saying that if you're not in a difficult or a harmful situation, but ultimately you have to manage your fear. Otherwise, you're going to go crazy. And we each have to process our own ways of coping with fear, you know, because everything works differently for different people. So, and if you don't work with your fear and anxiety, it will manifest in your body as sickness. There's no doubt about that. You know, constant fear will make your body sick. So this image of mine called Riverboat has also a very, it's almost overcoming fear, this image. It's about overcoming fear. Overcoming fear, wiping away the darkness, and finding your own light, finding who you are. Because remember, beneath that fear, there's a love that cannot die. Once you dive into your fear, into your own fear, once you dive into the world, the fear of the world, the fear of your neighbor, the fear of your husband, the fear of whoever it is, and you go beyond that, you go past it, there is a love that cannot die. And as long as we identify with something that is separate from us, as long as we identify that we continuously think the other person is separate from us, this just creates more fear. It's a very basic primal thing that we've been given, and we have to use that because it helps us to survive. But when it runs your life, it's not healthy. It's not a healthy situation at all. You know, to finding more inner peace, to finding peace, knowing, diving in. And I'm going to do, this is the first part series on Beyond Fear. And the next episode is going to be about feeling the fear, actually working. How many of you would like me to do a short meditation on one of the morning lives? So that some of you might never have experienced a meditation, but then I would need to have quite a few people sitting there. But understanding that beyond fear, diving deep into it, just think about that. Feel that in your bodies. There is a love that cannot die. And we are just merely one droplet of the ocean. And what does that mean? It means that this body vessel that's with us will one day be left behind. And what we have left is your spirit, your breath, that is collected, that is connected to the whole, the vastness. Now, you might read about that in a book or watch a video about it. But, you know, until you've experienced yourself, until you've experienced that in your body, knowing what that actually feels like, does it become real? And Marianne Williamson wrote, and this is a very famous quote, and we all know it, our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant, gorgeous, talented, fabulous? Actually, who are we not to be? And I invite you this Sunday evening to join my retreat, Wild at Heart Retreat. It's an online retreat. You can just WhatsApp me, or you can just send me an email or inbox me if you'd like to join. So I hope that today it's just given you some thought, even if it's just recognizing. You know, I've spoken to people this morning who said, I'm not afraid, I only get afraid sometimes. It's not true though, because it's with us all the time, whether it comes out in you forcing your children, or whether it comes out in I'm an obsessive compulsive cleaner, or whether it comes out in an overachiever or a workaholic, or underlying in all of us is this fear of not being enough, fear of dying, fear of being lonely, fear of being strangled, fear of being isolated. You know, you might have people who constantly want to do things. They're busy, busy, busy. As long as you are recognizing where is that fear coming from, sit with it. You see people drink it away, they take drugs, they run away, they run from partner to partner, or they have to have a lot of people around them. And there's nothing heart-warming having a lot of people around you, because we are pack animals and we do need support. So the thing is to question your fear. Question, where does it come from? What is it? What is it linked to? And I think I'm trying to think of the name, but there was an ancient person who, one of the ancients said, name it. Name that fear. I feel fear because I feel intimidated. I feel fear. And largely, we'll talk about it that in the second thing. It becomes from our belief systems. You know, what is this fear? So many times we've heard, the opposite of fear is love, but it doesn't, yes, it understands it here, but we have to dive into that fear. We have to dive into our fear, to sit with it, to know, to really know and understand deep inside of us, there is a love that cannot die. Isn't that beautiful when we think about that? There's a love in us that cannot die. So I leave that with you today on this beautiful Wednesday, in hoping that you will find within your anxiety and your fear and your tension throughout the day or throughout the week, that you will find that space within yourself where you know that love cannot die. And the risk is all just a mask. I hope to see you Sunday evening. I hope you will join us. Have a beautiful week.